Hello friends, I am Dr. Breach Thely. So I have been trying to make this video for over 2-3 weeks now since the spike of the second wave of COVID-19 started. But somehow I haven't been even able to get a couple of hours straight to make this presentation. Hopefully I can start with it today and can proceed it till the logical conclusion of what I want to share for information of everyone. See, just a couple of things I would like to clarify before starting today's discussion. The first thing is that I'll be going a bit fast. I am in shortage of time, so I may not cover all the topics which have been previously discussed over the last few videos that I have made. Of course, we started in 2020 with face-to-face discussions, about 50-60 training sessions we have had, but post that we only had online meetings and webinars, most of them private webinars, so we haven't been able to record that. But as far as possible, I try to keep updating new stuff, various strategies and guidelines out of the COVID management scenario that we are facing, and post regularly on statuses and Facebook and our Telegram channel. So I'll be going a bit fast. Also, you can rewatch this video as many times as you want. You can take screenshots. Also, at the end of the session, I'll be sharing the link of this entire PowerPoint. So relax and listen to me. Also, I may skip a few slides which have been discussed in our previous video, which is already available on YouTube. So maybe that part also I can omit a bit. And I would be considering that the basics of COVID-19 treatment for mild to moderate cases and the various terminologies you are already well aware of. So I may not be discussing that right now. So let us start straight away. The purpose of today's discussion is about managing the coronavirus patients in a dedicated COVID health center, that is DCHC, where you may have mild to moderate category, mainly moderate category of cases, with a limit of SpO2 up to 90%, where the facility of oxygen is available in such setup, but we do not have any ICU or advanced ventilatory support available. So with that, we begin that what is the aim of this presentation? The aim being training doctors day in and day out. More and more centers are available. More and more centers are being built. Thousands and thousands of new beds are being put up with oxygen facility, and more healthcare staff is being employed into this warlike battle. So this session is meant for all those MBBS, homeopaths, physiotherapists, dentists, support staff, the nursing students, the medical students, the interns, who will be the frontline treating doctors in such setups with a remote supervision or once a day or dedicated visits by a expert physician, which may not be possible at all the center due to the number of cases which is spiking at a very, very rapid pace. So what I want is, I want you guys to be prepared and aware to handle with the situation yourself in a way that you can manage mild to moderate cases at a COVID center. What things you need to care about, what things you should refer to your physician. Teleconsultation will always be available. You can just give a call to us and we'll be able to guide you what exactly you need to do with your patient. So I keep on updating stuff again and again. So the last one and a half year has been full of guidelines and trainings. I've taken more than 50 training sessions. I don't remember where I started on day one, and now we know so many more things about the virus, and that's how it's still going to continue for a few more months at least. So we need to be aware about managing the COVID-19 cases. All right. So basics, you all know the virus originated in Wuhan in Hubei province of China. And China informed WHO on 31st December 2019 about presence of such a virus in Wuhan sea market. And then later on, WHO declared it as a emergency, health emergency of international concern on 30th January 2020, and later declared pandemic on March 11, 2020. The first case in India was noted on 30th January 2020 in Kerala, and the first case in Gujarat was reported in Surat and Rajkot, specifically me being part of that particular first team to handle the case. That was on March 19, 2020. So these are the basic things. You know, it is an RNA virus, came from a bat. The incubation period is 14 days, median being up to 5 days. It works via the ACE2 receptors, just like the SARS and MERS virus, which we have already seen in the past. So I'll keep aside all these things. Also, there are a few videos in my presentation, which I'll be sharing on the Telegram group. You may have a look at it. Various PPE donning doffing videos and all. Yes, various health measures for protecting ourselves, which we know, hand hygiene, respiratory hygiene, various solid and biomedical waste management things, which I may skip for now because most of it has been already discussed since we are already working on this over a year now. The techniques of hand washing, I'm keeping these things in this slide so that we may get the refresher again and again whenever we want, and whenever we pass on this technique to our juniors, our students of UG and nursing, the slide can be a ready made preparatory manual for them to get to the level which we have reached over the year or so. So hand washing with sanitizer for 20 seconds, and with soap water you use it for 40 seconds. The step video is also there, you can see it later. Same way, we should know the steps of donning and doffing. Also, video is available. You can say briefly, first put on the gown, then the mask, then the goggles, and then the gloves while putting up the PPE, that is called donning. And while doffing the PPE, the sequence should be first remove the gloves, then the goggles, then the gown, lastly the mask or the respirator, that is called doffing. Now, when we work in a COVID setup, we should make sure that few strict rules about maintaining an isolation ward are being followed. Ideally, there should be a room with negative pressure, which may not be possible at a COVID health center level. But at least what we can do is we can implement proper staffing policies that no other person is allowed except for the healthcare worker, that too with proper PPE. And the log of entry and exit of each entering person should be maintained. And the equipments used inside a COVID isolation ward should be dedicated, should not be used for other non-COVID facilities. Speaking about the clinical presentation of COVID, we have been seeing cases over a year now. So we all know that the symptoms resemble those of URTA primarily, fever, cough, dyspnea, myalgia, fatigue. And the fatigue is a very specific and very important symptom, which the patients describe as weakness. Apart from it, few other symptoms very specific to COVID are described. They may be loss of smell and loss of taste, which in fact are associated with good prognosis. So usually those having ageusia and anosmia do not proceed to the LRTA phase. They usually end up having only mild infection with mild symptoms. We all know about these things. We all know about the risk factors about the severe disease. We also know that almost 80% of COVID cases can be managed at home. They are the mild cases. Around 14 to 15% will be the moderate cases, which will be the main area of interest in today's discussion, so that we may stop letting those cases to the tertiary center or the ICU center where the dedicated COVID hospital is there, where the 5% cases where the ventilatory support can be required, they can be managed properly, and so that the entire system may work efficiently. So there can be various presentations of a COVID patient from mild to moderate to severe. If the patient presents without fever, it may still have flu-like symptoms, muscle pain, cough, sore throat. So this is various subset of patients which may present to you. Some patient may have flu-like symptoms along with fever associated with loss of smell. There may be a specific subset, please remember, of patients not having respiratory complaint but having gastrointestinal complaint, specifically diarrhea. So you need to take these patients into consider, not just treat them as just any other AGE, but evaluate for COVID as well. And of course, the severe category, as I told you, fatigue or weakness is a very specific indication. If a patient tells you that I have been having progressively increasing fatigue compared to the previous days, you may keep in mind that the patient may be progressing towards a severe form of COVID with significant lung involvement. And of course, confusion and other respiratory embarrassments may occur at a later stage of a severe COVID-19. Now, one particular thing which I want you guys to know, and maybe one of the take-home messages of today's discussion, is recognizing the first day of illness. Oh, see, what we have learned over the last one and a half years is the COVID is not a 1 or 2 day thing. It is basically almost a couple of week scenario where initially the patient may have mild symptoms, but gradually over the next week or the second week specifically, the patient may progress to develop moderate to severe kind of symptoms. Patient may get desaturation. Patient may have specific pathophysiologies of COVID, cytokine storm, that is what it is called, beginning with hyperinflammation. I'll discuss in subsequent slides. We already discussed in the basic beyond basics lecture. Anyway, so recognizing day one of illness is very important. You should ask a direct question, which was the first day you noted the first symptom before which you are absolutely normal. Please remember, this is not the day of testing COVID-19 positive. If a patient is coming to you with having treatment somewhere else, please make sure that this first day is not the first day of the positivity. It is the day, first day of the symptom. So you should remember. So which is the symptom he noted first, and from there you count the day. It is very, very important. So usually the patients which would be managed at a DCHC or a dedicated COVID health center are the ones belonging to moderate category. The mild and very mild cases may be treated at home with home care or maybe at COVID care center, CCC. And the 5% patients, as I told, who require ventilatory and advanced ICU management may be referred or treated at dedicated COVID hospital. So in all these three subsets of COVID-related hospitals, the CCC, DCHC and DCH, we have a separate facility for suspect and positive patients. Some patients may be directly received as positive. They may be treated either elsewhere or directly diagnosed and shifted to your facility. Accordingly, you can decide and triage them into a particular place. So in a moderate category patient, the SpO2 lies somewhere between 90 to 94. The respiratory rate may be 24 to 30 per minute. There may be fever with a bit breathing difficulty, not acute respiratory distress, which requires BiPAP or ventilatory support. And the X-ray or CT may be showing evidence of pneumonia, but with less than 50% involvement. So this is the algorithm for isolation of various COVID patients at various levels of CCC, DCHC, and a dedicated COVID hospital. And the same thing applies for government as well as private facilities. So usually the same protocol may be followed in a private nursing home who is treating moderate cases. So the same rules, the same principles, the same strategies and guidelines apply for them as well. Okay. So a DCHC is a place where you treat the patient who requires oxygen and who is not having any additional complication, which may require higher expert care. And yes, these are the points you need to remember. So you would be dealing with these patients and that too alone. So please make sure you know. Also, the staff there must be trained for basic life support, and there must be facility to refer or transfer a patient to a tertiary care center, that is a dedicated COVID hospital, if the patient during the course of treatment progresses from moderate to severe category. As I said, the patient may be having pneumonia with signs of respiratory rate between 25 to 30 and SpO2 between 90 to 94, and there should not be any sign of severe disease. I'll tell you what can be the signs of severe disease when you need to shift the patient. All right. So what do you do at a DCHC? What do you do at a private or a government nursing home taking COVID positive patients with moderate category of illness? So first you review the entire history. The patient may be coming from home isolation because COVID is a 2-week disease. It's a 2-3 week game. So initial days, the patient may be categorized as a mild COVID patient. So the patient at a particular point needs to be recategorized into moderate or severe as required. So the patient may already have been under treatment somewhere else or at home and may be referred to you for further management. So you need to review the entire treatment history taken so far, the history of past medical records, and you need to note it down. Take the vitals, take the treatment history taken for COVID over the last few days, note down any investigations which have already been done, and shift the patient to the required facility for further management. You can just inform the consultant if you have any doubt. Otherwise, as per the protocol of your particular center, just start the treatment. The protocols are very much similar in almost all centers with minor center to center variation. So that's how you proceed. Remember, you are the one making the actual on-patient evaluation and treatment decisions. Yes, of course, physician visits as per the schedule or more so teleconsultation may be available in selected situation, but he still relies on your findings. So he may not be able to assess the patient as good or with as much time as you have given. So when you give us a call, you make sure you follow the primary steps, enlist the things you need to ask, where you are confused, where you need some guidance, and ask those specific points. Also anticipate in advance that if you are asking a question, the physician may need some additional information like some investigations, some history, some medication related question. So you make sure you have all those answers with you whenever you try to go for a teleconsultation with a physician. Yes, it's always a good practice to follow uniform principles and sequence of clinical examination and treatment so that the approach can be uniform. Whoever is the treating consultant, whoever is the medical officer there who is giving a call. So uniform practice, fast management, and better management can be followed. This slide is very important for you. What exactly do you do daily in a dedicated COVID health center while treating patients over your duty in your clinical rounds? So every 4 hourly you monitor, ask for symptoms, whether there is any worsening or improvement, or any additional complaints, specifically fatigue. You ask about the well-being of the patient. Is there any breathing difficulty? And you compare that to the previous days. Ask the patient whether you are feeling better than the previous day, whether you are having increased weakness or decreased weakness or any progression of symptoms or whatever it is, and note it down in your notes. Similarly, every 4 hourly, measure the temperature, pulse, blood pressure, saturation, and respiratory rate, and mention it in your clinical notes. See, this thing is important because you need to time and again reclassify the patient. The patient may progress from mild to moderate, moderate to severe. The patient may stay in the moderate category. The patient may be improving from moderate category and later on eligible for discharge. So you need to take care of all these things. You monitor the oxygen requirement of the patient, compare it with the previous requirement and see whether the trend is increasing requirement, rapidly increasing requirement or O2, or the patient is gradually improving and having decreased requirement. Similarly, maintain the sugars of the patient. If the patient is diabetic, you don't need to be over aggressive in sugar control. Somewhere around 200 of a random sugar or a postprandial sugar would be satisfactory. If the sugar is shooting around above 300-400, then use insulin to treat it. Don't use oral hypoglycemic. If the patient is on oral hypoglycemics, stop it. Treat it with insulin. And if the patient is having symptoms correlated with diabetic ketoacidosis, you may try testing it by urine ketone strip, easily available in all the smaller centers as well. You may just pour the strip in the urine and you will know whether the patient is having ketonuria or not. Then if required, you can refer to your physician and ask him about the further management. Similarly, daily, not the day of the illness, from the first symptom. Remember, it's not the day of admission, not the day of COVID positive, it is day of first symptom. The patient may have previously taken treatment at a village, a peripheral center, later on referred to some other hospital, then coming to you. So there may be a chain of events having taken place over the course of the patient's illness. So you need to make sure which day of illness is from the first symptom, very first symptom, before which the patient was absolutely normal. You also not the day of admission. For your satisfying your hospital policy, your deciding criteria and everyone. But for clinical grounds, the day of symptom is the most important thing. This thing should be very clear. Also not the day of important medications like remdesivir, antibiotics, steroid and enoxaparin, which you would be usually using in most of your patients admitted. So if you are using any of these medicines, make sure to write the day of the medicine, which is the present day. So later on, if it is required to be discontinued, if the patient is improving, we may plan to discontinue few medication, we may taper down or stop few medicines, we may plan to continue it further. Sometimes some medicines are usually required to be given only for 4 days, 5 days as per the requirement. But if you don't write down the day, the patient may keep on getting it for the entire course of this day. So writing the day of medication is very important. Also, not the previous investigation. See, if a COVID panel was done after, before 3-4 days, and whether some other institution where the patient has previously taken treatment, whether you have taken the investigations in your institute, mention that investigation and see the trend of blood markers and investigation, and order the fresh investigation only as required. If the patient is stable, you may defer the repeat investigation by up to 72 hours. You may plan not to repeat some particular investigation which is static over last 2-3 times. See, just the same way as we are having shortage of medicines, shortage of oxygen, shortage of staff, there is a shortage of investigations and kits also. So we make sure we use the investigations judiciously. There are times when we don't have D-dimer facility available at the entire setup in the entire city. So we want to avoid such circumstances. So we use our brains, use the pathophysiology of COVID, use the previous investigations to order only required fresh investigations, which may aid our further decision making. Say, for example, if the CRP is high previously, and if the next CRP was showing a decreased trend, and the steroids are already ongoing, we may try to defer the next investigation. Instead of 24 to 48 hours, we repeat at 72 hours and even further if the patient is clinically improving, because just noting it down again will not make major difference in any treatment. But if the patient is worsening, yes, so in those selected cases we may plan to have a earlier investigation. So that is where your role as a doctor is, to use your brains, use your clinical knowledge to apply in the best possible manner to be beneficial to the patient as well, as well as to use the resources in a very judicious manner. We are fighting it in a warlike scenario. We don't want to use our resources and waste it. So please note. And of course, while taking your daily round, you make sure you make appropriate dose adjustment, appropriate treatment adjustment as per the existing protocol in your setup, as ordered by your physician. If a new patient is there, write proper history, inform the physician as required. If the patient is not tested, you shift in the suspect ward. If the patient is positive, shift in the positive ward and start treatment as per the pre-existing protocol. The protocol of centers may vary from center to center based on the local availability, the suitability, cost, experience of the center, as well as the evolving guidelines. So that may be changing from time to time. But yes, you should keep a watch on them and follow as per your center. And of course, you should keep triaging the patient. If a patient is improving or deteriorating, you should be aware during your round. If the patient is deteriorating and fitting the criteria of a severe COVID-19 patient, then inform your physician or the authority of the hospital and plan to shift the hospital to a dedicated COVID hospital so that further ventilatory management, ICU management can be taken place and better management can be offered to the patient. Similarly, if the patients are eligible for discharge, if the discharging criteria are satisfied, you make a note that these are the eligible patients which I can discharge today, which I can discharge tomorrow. And as per the satisfaction of the criteria, you inform your consultant and give them discharge with a proper discharge card, with all the discharging advice, treatment given, all the investigations and the treatment on discharge noted. And also explain to the patient what are the signs when you need to consult, what are the medicines you need to continue for what particular period. So this, and when you need to come for follow-up if at all required. So this is very important. This slide is something which you will do day in and day out while treating a COVID patient. You may be an MBBS student, you may be a MBBS graduate, medical officer, homeopath, Ayurved, physiotherapist, dentist, whichever category. We are in a warlike situation. You all must know these basic things. We learn in our undergraduate curriculum itself. So I don't think there is anything which is difficult. This is all basics, and I'm very sure you would be able to implement and proceed. So you assess the patient for risk factor. You know which are the risk factor of severe disease. So this is the list, and accordingly your treatment should also be matching. Say for example, if your patient is having a history of heart failure, you don't give over fluids to the patient. Don't just spoil the existing picture of the patient by unnecessary use of medications or something which may harm the patient. So you make proper note of the various risk factors for severe disease. Also by using this list, you would be aware that if you are having a patient with one of these risk factors, then while taking a round, you must be aware that out of the 40-50 patients which you are handling, these are the 5 patients which are having high risk factor, which are having comorbidities, which may have a higher chance of progression to severe COVID-19 infection over the next few days, over the second week. So you may be extra cautious about them. You may explain them in more detail, whether they develop some particular symptom, whether they develop breathlessness, then they should be attended to first, and so that they can be referred to a tertiary care center at an appropriate time. Similarly, as I said, you may pick up the investigation as per the requirement. Watch for the lymphocytes in your CBC. That is the most important thing. Also, you don't need to repeat X-ray unless it is required. At many centers, X-ray or HRCT facility may not even be available. So before going for any investigation, just make sure whether there is any diagnostic or treatment-wise utility of a particular, if CBC is enough. I want to see the viral picture is there or not. I want to see whether lymphopenia is existing or it has improved. Then you just go for CBC. If the patient is having raised CRP, and if you have started the treatment, you want to see the response of the treatment, you can repeat only CRP. So this is the list of investigation. If you want to go for tocilizumab, you may need to rule out sepsis. So in such case, you may order a procalcitonin. So these are the things you take decision at a particular point of time. There is a no fixed rule. So if a requisition form is there, don't just take out everything. No, don't do that. Wait for the investigation. If you have any doubt, you may consult your senior. You may consult your colleague what to send, what not to send. So this is very important. So out of this list, go for only those investigation which are available to you and which can aid in your clinical management of the patient. Very important. So as I said, you monitor the patient, monitor. COVID-19 is a game of monitoring. Pick up the patient at the right stage. Till then, keep on monitoring and aid the treatment which the patient needs at that particular point. So if a patient is diagnosed with COVID-19 today, the patient may be mild, but the patient may end up being on venti on day 10. So during those 10 days, you try to pick up. If the patient is worsening, try to give early management. Give steroid at the particular time. Don't give blanket steroid to all patients. Ask your physician. Physician is the right guy to take all the patient, all the decisions. So if any confusion, if you are having a physician teleconsultation facility, you prepare a list of patients for which you want to ask questions. You anticipate few questions which the physician may ask you, and then make a call and then address all the queries altogether. That's how you proceed. So you can just, this is a baseline of what you must do. Monitoring every 4 to 6 hourly, investigation 2 days or 3 days maybe even. So this is how you should proceed with the treatment. Now the next question arises, when to teleconsult a physician? So if your physician has given you particular advice, you follow that, keep on following that. But if one of these features is present, then you may make an early call to your physician for emergency guidance for a particular patient, and then follow the appropriate fresh advice which are being given. So if the patient is having persistent difficulty in breathing, the patient may have on and off difficulty in breathing, but it may usually settle down. The patient may have gone to the washroom. Coming back, the patient may feel tachypneic and breathless. You may have a momentary desaturation, but once the patient settles down for half an hour, the tachypnea goes off, the saturation again comes up with the oxygen, then you need to wait. So if the patient is in persistent respiratory rate above 30, persistent SpO2 less than 90, even with the maximum O2, if you are having a capacity of up to 15 liters by NRBM, and even with that oxygenation, if the patient is having less than 90% SpO2, yes, there is proper saturation. Similarly, if the patient is having persistent pain or pressure in the chest, maybe some cardiac event, so you need to attend it. But before doing that, you get an ECG, get a drop or CKMB, whichever is available in your setup, and then you inform the physician so that whenever he asks, you would have already sent him the image of the ECG and the report, or at least you would have ordered that so that the process of getting the report may be in line with your consultation, and then follow the advice. Similarly, if the patient is having altered sensorium, mental confusion, inability to arouse, slurred speech, seizures, weakness of numbness of any one limb or face, thrombotic tendency is very common in COVID-19. You may end up getting strokes and MI as well. If the patient is having bluish discoloration of lips or face, there is continuous and uncontrollable or profuse bleeding from any site, or if the patient needs to be referred to a DCH, then you can just consult your physician before referring the patient. So remember these points. So these are the red flag signs clinically what we discussed. Similarly, if the neutrophil lymphocyte ratio is progressively increasing to more than 3 or 3.5, the CRP is progressively increasing compared to the previous results, D-dimer is progressively improving along with the clinical picture of deterioration, yes, you may take a call of informing your physician. Remember, the second week is the most crucial. The median time to deterioration of a COVID-19 patient to involve the lower respiratory rate or develop a ARDS is around 8 to 12 days. So if the patient is in the second week, you please be extra cautious. The second week is the time where the deterioration can occur. Along with the clinical correlation and the markers, if a high-grade fever is there, say a continuous fever not controlled by paracetamol, then yes, you may consider taking a physician opinion for an alternative or advanced treatment, which can be either offered at your center or you may need to refer the patient. All right. So now we discuss about the discharge criteria. So see, the bed issues are there all over. So the moment you see that the patient is stable and satisfying the guidelines for discharge, you may take a call and discharge the patient as required. So the criteria is very simple for a moderate case at the DCH. See, if the patient has presented to you as a moderate case with fever, if the patient is afebrile for 3 days and maintaining SpO2 above 95% for the next 4 days, and if total 10 days have been completed from the symptom onset, and the patient is asymptomatic, afebrile without use of any antipyretics, no breathlessness, SpO2 maintained above 95%, yes, they may be considered for discharge. So two things we need to remember for discharging the COVID-19 patients. First is, please remember, there is no need of repeat RT-PCR or a rapid testing. You may directly discharge if the criteria are satisfied. Remember, RT-PCR repeat test or an antigen test repeat is not required. The patient may have a repeat RT-PCR positive, may still be discharged if the criteria are satisfied. Please remember, don't waste kits. RT-PCR kits are in a big shortage. So please remember, don't waste kits. RT-PCR repeat testing is not required for discharging the patient from a DCHC. And at the time of discharge, you will also mention this in the discharge card. You will advise the patient to self-monitor the health for next 7 days at home with proper home isolation. So this takes care of the infectious part as well as the worsening part. If the worsening is going to happen over the third week or so, still they may be picked up over around the next 7 days. So please remember. Also, if the patient is on oxygen and fever does not resolve for 3 days, then treat the patient, continue the treatment as long as the patient becomes asymptomatic. And if the patient becomes asymptomatic with saturation being maintained above 95% for 3 consecutive days, you may discharge the patient. So this is the discharge criteria given by the Ministry of Health and Family Welfare. Very clear for mild and moderate cases, no need of repeat RT-PCR testing. Please remember, this is the most important part of this. Many patients in at home treatment also get repeat RT-PCR testing just to make sure whether they are having still coronavirus or not. But this thing is not reliable. The dead virus may also be detected, and you may also end up having RT-PCR positive up to 90 days after your first positive. So please remember not to repeat. See, the only utility of repeat RT-PCR is in a severe case, and that too for a very specific thing. If the patient has become a chronic patient in a DCH, in a dedicated COVID hospital, with a prolonged management, 2-3 weeks, and if the patient requires to be shifted to a non-COVID setup for further management, the patient may be requiring supportive management because the chronic phase may take weeks together to improve. So in such cases, if you repeat the RT-PCR and if that ends up getting negative, that would mean that the patient may not further be infectious to others, so that the patient can be well managed along with other non-COVID patients in a non-COVID setup for as long as required, and that particular bed can be offered to another severe category of COVID positive patient. So please remember the deciding criteria. It's very simple. 10 days from symptom onset, no O2 requirement for 3 days, and no RT-PCR required. It's clear, no doubt. All right. Now we talk about the diagnosis of COVID-19. Now, so as we discussed the clinical picture of COVID-19 that can be clubbed together in what we call as clinical diagnosis. The next things which we'll be discussing further will be molecular diagnosis, laboratory diagnosis, and radiological diagnosis. So a few of these things we already discussed in our previous video, the All About Corona video, already available on YouTube. So I may consider it as already seen by you. And if you have not seen, you can go back and see that video. So many things coming in the further slides are already discussed. Some extra things which are relevant and important for our DCHC management and overall, I'll tell you. So for screening of a patient by RT-PCR, the first line assays include the E-gene, N-gene, and S-gene. And the confirmatory assays which stem the diagnosis would be the RNA-dependent RNA polymerase, that is RDRP and ORF1B gene. Please remember the gold standard, the authentic diagnostic test of COVID-19 is RT-PCR. All right, no CT, not rapid test. I'll tell you something about rapid test in the coming slides. So sometimes what they do is they are having so much samples, so they pull the samples and many samples are tested together. So first they run the first line screening test, ENNS gene. If one of them is positive, then they run all the samples separately for confirmatory assays. By doing so, they may decrease the number of kits being used, and it's a worldwide use kit saving practice. The ideal time of RT-PCR is within 3 days, but not later than 7 days of symptom development. A nasal swab and a throat swab, both are taken. Also, one very important thing which is circulating so wide and far and which is leading to patients going for RT-PCR even after rapid test positive, that is the cycle threshold or the CT value of RT-PCR. They want to know how much infectious they are. So please remember, there is a CT value, what is called as cycle threshold, written in your RT-PCR report. There are evidences that it may be related with infectiousness. The lower the value, the patient may be higher infectious or more infectious. It has no relation with severity. So it's not like that the patient is having more higher load than the patient is having severe illness. We have seen hundreds and hundreds of patients with lower CT value but mild case, and with almost negligible or cutoff, near cutoff high level of value, but ending up being on ventilator. So even ICMR has given the guideline. You can check on the ICMR website. The notification is on 5th August 2020 that it is not recommended to rely on numerical CT values for determining infectiousness of COVID-19 patient and deciding patient management protocol. It has no effect on the patient management. RT-PCR or rapid test is only for diagnostic purpose. No prognosis, no management decisions can be taken. All right. So please remember, there is no need of testing. The process of taking swab, I have given the video. You can see later on when you download the slide at the end of the session. So something about the antigen test or the rapid test, what we call it as point of care test or RAT. Now, the big thing or the good thing about this, we have discussed this in much detail in our previous video. So I'll just point out two, three things. That the result of a rapid test can be readily available within 15 minutes or at the max 1 hour. It can be done at the bedside of the patient. So this is very, very useful basically for faster diagnosis. But please, please, please remember two things I would like to mention. And this is something which is actually, I don't know from where it has come, imprinted exactly opposite in minds of so many general population, as well as so many of our colleagues as well. So please remember, if a rapid test is positive, then it is considered to be positive. The patient is having COVID-19. You don't need to go for a repeat RT-PCR, either to confirm or for your CT value purpose. Don't do it. Don't waste the kid. Start the treatment straight away. Please remember this. If a rapid test is positive, don't go for RT-PCR. It's clearly given in guideline. It's given all over. I don't know why things are being followed exactly opposite. So please remember, if a rapid antigen test is positive, the patient is having COVID positive, irrespective of symptoms, and you don't need to go for RT-PCR. On the contrary, if the rapid test is negative and the patient is suspected of COVID-19 with proper symptoms, then you need to go for RT-PCR. So I don't know, many are roaming around that my rapid test is negative, so I am not having coronavirus. But even though they may be symptomatic, they may have fever, if the patient is a strong suspect with rapid negative, then you go for RT-PCR for confirmation. This is very important. All right. So please remember, if the patient is having rapid test positive, don't go for RT-PCR, treat it as positive. If the patient is having rapid test negative and the patient is symptomatic, go for RT-PCR and confirm. Although there are cases now, probably due to various mutations ongoing, which have rapid test negative, repeat rapid test negative, RT-PCR negative, two or three RT-PCR negative, symptomatic, even with lung involvement on HRCT, but we treat them clinically as COVID-19. So this is the scenario which is arising in today's second wave crisis, where there are cases with rapid negative, RT-PCR negative, COVID-19, where the treatment decision has to be done by an expert MD medicine, a physician who takes the call for managing the patient as a COVID-19 case, in spite of the molecular diagnostic technique being negative. All right, so please remember. Also, I will repeat that rapid test is not an antibody test. It is an antigen test. There is no antibody test, no blood test to diagnose COVID-19. Rapid test is also a nasal swab. All right, these are very, very basic things. I think we need to make clear of this. At the same time, also remember that whichever the way COVID patient is diagnosed, rapid test or RT-PCR, both have to be duly registered in the RT-PCR app and informed to the authority. So both are bound to be considered as positive only. Now we talk about some other investigations, the blood investigations, the lab investigations, which are routinely used while managing a COVID-19 patient, and the utility, of course. See, the very commonly used investigations and the abnormalities which we seek for in a COVID patient are either a lymphopenia or an increased NLR ratio, neutrophil lymphocyte ratio, which is suggestive of a strong viremia and related with more severe course of the disease later on. And patient may need to be reclassified at a later stage if required and treated accordingly in a moderate or a severe category. Also associated findings are increased D-dimer, prolonged PT, also various other markers, increased ferritin, increased LDH, increased CPK. Of course, now the utility of all these other inflammatory markers have been superseded by using only CRP. We don't usually go for ferritin or LDH or any other marker unless we are in a diagnostic dilemma. We go for only CBC, CRP, D-dimer is a common protocol for monitoring during the course of the treatment. If the patient is on any hepatotoxic or a renotoxic medication, then we may repeat the LFTs, RFTs as required as well. And other markers like IL-6 in specific scenarios where we may require to use tocilizumab for cytokine storm, I'll tell you in due course. So the various range of markers which may be correlated with the severity of disease can be inferred from these chartings as per mild, moderate, and severe category. If the NLR ratio, CRP, ferritin, D-dimer, LDH, IL-6 are associated in this particular range, it may be considered to be a progression or an improvement accordingly. So these are the various markers associated with severe COVID-19 infection consistent with the diagnosis of cytokine storm. So if the CRP is greater than 100, if the D-dimer is more than 1000, and there is a progressive increase or doubling in any of the markers, then that may be significant enough a value. Next, we'll discuss the COVID radiology. Radiological investigations, please remember, a chest X-ray or an HRCT should be avoided in the early days of the disease. In the early days or in the mild disease, you may not have any utility of chest X-ray. In fact, HRCT is the one which is being commonly used for COVID-19. So the findings are more so in the later phase of the disease, and that may aid the prognosis and the progression of the disease and not really helpful in diagnosis unless we have a rapid and RT-PCR negative type of COVID, where the specific findings in case of COVID seen in your HRCT may be useful for diagnosis as well. So in the initial days, the HRCT does not have any value. There are hundreds of cases which we have seen where the initial scoring of HRCT may be suggestive of less severe disease, but just within next 5-6 days, the patient may have worsened, and then a repeated CT would have shown a totally different picture. So initial HRCT may not aid to the diagnosis. So try to delay or avoid HRCT as far as possible. Please remember, not every patient of COVID-19, irrespective of category, needs an HRCT or a repeat HRCT. All right. The only importance of HRCT is in the prognosis of the patient. We may know how much the lungs of the patient are involved, 80%, say 75%. Based on that, we may know how long the patient is going to take to improve. How long do we need to continue the treatment? How much time the patient would take to recover from a venti or a BiPAP or an O2 accordingly. So please remember, HRCT is not required in all cases. We have already discussed in our previous video which are the typical findings suggestive more likely of a COVID in a diagnostic manner, which are the features: ground glass opacities, peripheral, basal, subpleural opacities, which may correlate strongly with the COVID-19 infection, are suggestive of high likelihood of the COVID-19. Now, two things to remember. First of all, please remember that all clinicians, especially physicians, they already know how to read the HRCT plates. The workload is so much, sometimes we just get the plates. So all clinicians know, so you also try to imbibe some of the important features, how to know the severity of the illness just by looking at the plates of HRCT. So if we read a printed report of HRCT, we see two things. One is the CORED 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 or 6. So that CORED is associated with the increased likelihood of that particular CT being that of a COVID-19 patient, or increased likelihood that that particular patient has COVID-19. Leave aside the RT-PCR part. So there are very characteristic features, CORED 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 in increasing order, which suggests the likelihood of COVID-19. So remember one thing. And the next thing which is given in the HRCT printed report is what is called as the CT severity score. Now, this thing we haven't discussed in our previous session. So this I'll go a bit in details. So the scoring system is very simple. You should also know how to grade this scoring. And the importance of this scoring is that the more the value, the more severity or the more involvement in the lungs. And the increasing values of the CT score is associated more with increased age, more in male gender, more with rise in inflammatory markers and the severity of the clinical condition and the categorization of the patients accordingly. In fact, score more than 18 may be predictive of patient's mortality. So that is associated with poor prognosis. So as I said, HRCT is giving information on the prognosis. Now about the scoring, it's very simple. See, we all know that the right lung has 3 lobes and the left lung has 2 lobes. So it is a visual assessment score basically. So if we individualize the 5 lobes with a score from 0 to 5, if there is no involvement in a particular lobe, then we give 0 score for that. If there is less than 5% of a particular lobe getting involved with opacities, ground glass opacities, then we give a score of 1. If visually there is 5 to 25%, we give a score of 2. If it is 26 to 50%, we give a score of 3. If the involvement is 51 to 75% of that particular lobe, then the score given for that particular lobe is 4, if it is 51 to 75%. And if the involvement is more than 75% of that particular lobe, then we give it as a score of 5. So there are 5 lobes, each being given score from 0 to 5. Then we add the findings of all this. So it's not necessary that all the lobes may have involvement. Some lobes may have patchy involvements. Some lobes may be more involved than the other. So we total the score given to each of the 5 lobes. So if it is out of 25, we may get a score ranging from 0 to 25. And then the percentage involvement of the total lung, including both lungs, would be counted by multiplying the final output figure by 4. For example, if the CT severity score turns out to be 10 out of 25, then we may say that the lung involvement is 40% in that particular patient. So this gives us a gross idea about how much lung the patient would have had involved. In fact, the moment the patient starts to desaturate below 95, it is almost certain that the patient may have would have got somewhere ranging from 20 to 40% of involvement. And more the involvement, more the desaturation. So this is having a relation with the severity and suggestive of the good or bad prognosis. So the CORED value suggests the possibility of that particular CT being COVID-19, that particular patient having COVID-19, and the severity score suggesting of percentage involvement, that is the how severe the disease is. Previously, during the first wave, we used to have different scoring systems. Some followed the scoring out of 40, some followed out of 28, but now uniformly the accepted standard is of score out of 25. So we have discussed this. This is one of the good chat circulating on social media, I got, which has inclusiveness of all useful diagnostic parameters associated with COVID-19. The values of the blood investigation, CT scoring, which you need to remember. So if the CT score, severity score is less than 8, we may call it as a mild COVID, 9 to 15 moderate COVID, or greater than 15 it is severe COVID. So you may have the clinical correlation. If a patient is having SpO2 90 to 95, you may expect a CT severity score somewhere between 9 to 15 and vice versa. All right. So just to conclude the entire investigational marathon what we have gone through over the last few minutes, remember RT-PCR or a rapid test is for diagnosis, stamping that the patient is having COVID, no other utility, no value of repeat investigation. HRCT thorax is for prognosis and progression. The patient was asymptomatic or mildly symptomatic the first week. On the 8th or 9th day, if the CT is showing 60%, 70% involvement, then the prognosis is bad and it may have progressed over that particular period. And the blood panel, the CRP, the D-dimer, the interleukin 6, the blood panels which we go for are indicative of the hyperinflammation, that is the pathophysiology of COVID-19, or the COVID-associated coagulopathy, so which may be useful to guide the treatment. There are particular few group of drugs, steroids, low molecular weight heparin, which may be given in time to the patient so that the progression, further deterioration can be prevented. So these decisions, especially in mild to moderate cases, are guided by your blood investigations. And the improvement on those parameters is suggestive of improvement of the patient or overall. So please remember, it is very simple. What is CORAD score? What is CT severity score? We have discussed it all. So the treatment guidelines for mild, moderate and severe cases, initially what we followed were given by the Ministry of Health and Family Welfare last on the 3rd of July 2020. The recent guidelines we just got last week from AIIMS and ICMR as a combined protocol, which is the updated protocol of AIIMS, given on 22nd April. So this is the recent most guideline which we follow now. So in cases of moderate cases, we are specifically interested for moderate cases right now. So we all know the respiratory rate is between 24 and 30 SpO2. They've changed it to 93%, less than 93% on room air. So they mean to say that now up to 94% or more, you can treat at home. So you give oxygen support, you give anti-inflammatory or immunomodulatory therapy, that is steroids or methylprednisolone or dexamethasone. Your anticoagulation is required, conventional or low molecular weight heparin, that is your enoxaparin, which can be given to all those patients. And then you continue clinical monitoring, as we have discussed, the work of breathing, the hemodynamic instability, the change in oxygen requirement. I have told you all these things. The serial chest x-ray, if required, there is worst thing that you can compare both the chest x-rays or the HRCT, if at all required, if it's going to make any treatment decisions. Then only. And of course, the lab monitoring of CRP, D-dimer every 48 to 72 hours and CBC, RFT, LFT, etc. So we have already discussed all these things. This have been incorporated into the new guidelines of the Health Ministry, ICMR and the AIIMS. All right. Now the basic principles of managing patients in a medicine ward or a HDU or what you call it as primary principles of management are the same as we treat any other pneumonia or lung pathology. COVID-19 is essentially a pneumonia, especially a moderate COVID-19, which may later on to progress to ARDS. So we give oxygen inhalation, we give conservative fluid management. We don't give fluid if not required. So use fluid judiciously if there is no shock. So this is very important, and we manage it with close monitoring, as we all know. So permissive hypercapnia, permissive hypoxemia. So you may not need to take the SpO2 to 99% and make the oxygen valve to the full level. It's okay if the patient manages somewhere around 90, 92, 93. Even we may even allow it between 86 and 90% if other parameters are improving. About prone position is very, very effective. It gets us by some time for the effect of our steroids and other medicines. I'll discuss in detail in later slides. And of course, if the patient is having septic shock, we give antibiotics, we treat it accordingly as in case of any other patient by giving IV fluids and other management. Also, for respiratory support in case of COVID-19, please remember we try to delay the intubation as long as possible, because once the patient is intubated, the management becomes very difficult and the prognosis is very, very, very poor if a COVID-19 patient is intubated. So we try to use measures where we may get to avoid intubation in a COVID-19 patient. And at the same time, the recent shortage of oxygen, which we are facing all throughout India. So we have accumulated few suggestions from our dear friends and from my personal experience over one and a half years, how what we can do to save the existing oxygen and make it available for a longer period or make it available to more patients rather than exhausting it up on a single patient. So I have already shared this on social media. I will just briefly read it. Maintain the SpO2 around 90 to 95%. Don't need to target 100%. So if a high flow nasal cannula and an NIV both are available, use NIV, because the high flow nasal cannula may use up to 35, 40, 50 liters of O2 per minute, which is a huge amount of O2, which if we use it in NIV, we may save a lot more O2, which can be used in some other patient. See, an oxygen concentrator is something which prepares oxygen from the surrounding atmosphere and delivers up to 5 liter of oxygen. So that does not require the oxygen cylinder or an oxygen plant. It can be used anywhere, just like a mobile device. So if the requirement is up to 5 liters, so many patients are maintaining with 1 liter, 2 liters. So such patients can use oxygen concentrator so that we can avoid the central line. If a leakage is there, the leakage may cause 25% loss of oxygen. So you repair the leakage and other simple things like, say, if a patient is eating. So at that particular point of time, your oxygen may be switched off because a mask may be lying just beside the patient, just wasting the oxygen. The patient may have gone for washroom. You can switch off the oxygen for that particular procedure. These are simple measures. And if the patient has started maintaining SpO2, then use the lowermost point of oxygen requirement with which the patient may maintain around 90-95% SpO2. Don't target 99 or 100%. So if the patient is able to prone the patient from day one, if the requirement is there or not, because that will buy us time so that later on we may not need the higher requirements of oxygen. So irrespective of whether the patient is having O2 requirement or not, you prone the patient and train the staff for proning. Proning is a sophisticated technique if it is not a self-awake proning. And if you are using an NIV, use a nasal prong and then put a NIV. So that will have lesser usage of oxygen rather than connecting the tubing to the NIV machine. If an ambu bag is available, it is preferred over the Bain circuit. Of course, Bain circuit also lessens the oxygen usage, but an ambu bag is still a better option than a Bain circuit. Some patients or some staff I have seen, they nebulize the patient with O2 or a high flow nasal cannula. I don't know what is the rationale behind that, but don't use an O2 machine for nebulizing. Use a nebulizer to nebulize. It's as simple as possible. So avoid intubation as long as possible. Timely and evidence-based institution of steroids for hypoxia reversal. See, one thing, you don't start steroid in all the patients. Don't give early steroids. Don't give steroid unless it is indicated. That call should be a physician's call. It's a very, very, very intricate and minute level decision whether to give steroids or not. But when hypoxia is there, the indication is clear. You give steroid. It is a definitive therapy for reversal of hypoxia. And once started, don't discontinue abruptly. Let your physician decide. The patient may require a prolonged course of steroid on case-to-case basis. So if once started, don't give that. I'll give for 3 days and then taper down. Also, taper down is not required in all cases. The HPAXA suppression occurs only if the steroids need to be given more than 14 days. Up to 14 days, you can safely give the steroid and abruptly stop it. So these two aspects, once is when you start, don't stop abruptly one thing, and up to 14 days if you require to stop it, then you may directly stop it. So these are the two very delicate close aspect you need to focus on and emphasize on preventing COVIDology and pathophysiology based treatment. You address the pathophysiology, address viremia at the viral stage, address COVID associated coagulopathy at the coagulopathy at that particular stage, address the inflammation at the hyperinflammation or pulmonary phase. and promote usage of masks and what we call it as preventive COVIDology. It's a term which I have been often using it right now. So this can save a huge chunk of oxygen, and with that particular chunk, we may be able to serve many other part of the population. So please remember, I would reiterate that COVID is not a lung disease. It is a systemic thrombohyperinflammatory vasculitis or a vascular disease. Up to the initial phase, I'll show you in the further slides, initial 1 week or up to 9 days, it's the viral phase. So after 9 days, the viremia is gone, basically. Then we start getting the effect of that particular virus in form of either coagulopathy or inflammation or cytokine storm in the severe most cases. So these all are the things which help us manage intricately our COVID patients. Something which is very new or which is very unique to the case of COVID-19 is what we call it as happy hypoxia. I would like to make a note. I have been often discussing this in my previous lives and all my social media posts, but I would like to take it into this discussion, which is called happy hypoxia. See, this is why the role of your SpO2 probe comes into play. In usual non-COVID or the pre-COVID area lung pathologies, is the if the patient SpO2 went down or below 90, usually the patient would have breathing difficulty, so that the patient himself or herself may be symptomatic enough to let you know that he is having some respiratory problem. But the unique thing which was noted with COVID-19 was that patient, even though they were hypoxic, 90, 80, 70, I have seen up to 60 or 50 SpO2 patients, they don't have any breathlessness. They can maintain for quite some time on that particular SpO2, and hence we may miss the diagnosis of COVID-19, or we may miss judging the severity of the infection just by not using the SpO2 probe. Of course, the awareness of SpO2 probe is quite a lot now, so they are easily available, but as a clinician, we may need to remember this. So the reason for happy hypoxia is that the SARS-CoV-2 virus seems to have an effect on the respiratory control system, on the ACE2 receptors in the carotid body, at a site which chemoreceptor sends the oxygen, and they lead to the decreased sensitivity of these receptors. Also, the increased thrombogenesis, which is the COVID-associated coagulopathy, leads to thrombi in the pulmonary vasculature, which cause blunting of the dyspnea response to the J receptors, thereby leading to what we call it as silent or happy hypoxia. The patient is clinically well. But if we measure the SpO2 by the finger probe, you get around 80-85% SpO2, and they may need oxygen support and quick management. They may be into the moderate or the severe category by that time. Also, for measuring the SpO2, there are a few things which I would like to suggest. Firstly, use a good quality of SpO2 probe. There are SpO2 probes which may give a reading even by inserting a small pen. So those are not of good quality. They give good reading in all the patients. Also, the SpO2 probe needs to be put on the finger of the patient for some particular time, at least 15 seconds, ideally as per the health ministry guideline, up to 1 minute, with a static reading. It should not be fluctuating. And then that static reading is considered to be the right SpO2 for that particular patient. Now, there may or may not be difference in different fingers, but if you need to select one finger for accurate assessment, many research papers have shown that the right hand middle finger forms the preferred finger for reading SpO2 on a SpO2 probe. Hope this clears the air, right? So remember, you need to keep at least 15 seconds or ideally up to 1 minute with a static non-fluctuating reading. All right. So we already discussed now the pathophysiologic aspect in the previous session, but I'll give brief about important parts of each. See, there are two particular pathophysiologies associated with COVID-19, which we are targeting in treatment, all right, with various medications. The first one being that of cytokine storm, and other one being COVID-associated coagulopathy. For cytokine storm is an exaggerated or a quick progression of the COVID-associated hyperinflammation. Hyperinflammation would be suggested by markers like CRP, LDH, ferritin, which are the inflammatory markers, what we call acute phase reactants. Also, D-dimer is increased in hyperinflammation and cytokine storm. The second physiology, pathophysiology, which the COVID-19 causes is the COVID-associated coagulopathy, where there is a risk of thrombi formation. And in such cases also D-dimer may be high. So if the CRP and D-dimer both are high, we may suggest that both pathophysiologies are playing a part. If CRP is normal and D-dimer is high, we may say that patient is having a more component of COVID-associated coagulopathy. So based on that, we use specific treatment. Now, this slide is the most important slide of today's discussion. Probably the most important thing we need to spread, learn, study, and understand about COVID-19. I've already discussed this so many times in social media in previous training sessions, but I would like to keep on repeating it, because this is what the game changer is. See, I have been trying to tell you all through the last hour or so that we have been discussing that COVID is a two-week game. It's a two-week game. I have also posted on social media many times. The two-week game which progresses is explained by this particular phenomenon. Also, the day at which a particular treatment may be helpful is also suggested by this particular pathophysiology. So now what happens is, usually the COVID natural history in a particular patient can be divided into two parts. To simplify it, first week there is viral multiplication and viremia, and second week onwards there is host inflammatory response, that is hyperinflammation, which may be variable from patient to patient, and in many cases, not all cases, may progress to a rapidly inflammatory state, what we call it as cytokine storm. Somewhere between these two overlapping phases, the lungs start getting involved. Okay, so for the first week up to 9 days, the viremia is there. So in this particular phase, what is useful are the antivirals, your remdesivir, to some extent some people use ivermectin, favipiravir, HCQ. These were supposed to have antiviral action. So if at all you use these things, the ideal time of usage is the first week or up to 9 days at max. And the second half of the disease, that is from second week onwards, that is the hyperinflammatory phase. That is the phase where your inflammation sets in and your markers start rising, and the patient may rapidly deteriorate. The deterioration in the first week is very, very less compared to that in the second week. So many patients, they may be totally asymptomatic or mildly symptomatic in the first 5-6 days, but they usually progress very rapidly over the 6th, 7th, or 8th day, and they may end up being in ICU on BiPAP 20, etc. So you understand the situation. So to treat the second half of the disease, we target the pathophysiology. We target it using either steroids or lower molecular weight heparin. These are the two very widely used therapy for the inflammatory part. Of course, other therapies may be useful, like the tocilizumab in selected cases. And see, somewhere between the first phase and the hyperinflammation phase will be the pulmonary phase, where the pneumonia may set in. But that may overlap the viremic phase, and that may even overlap the hyperinflammatory phase. Hence, for the first 4-5 days, you may not get pneumonia. So don't be early in going for CT thorax. As I told you, CT thorax may have value only after 4-5 days and up to 8th or 9th days. So this is the phase where the pneumonia may set in, where you may detect the patient's lung picture by going for a CT. So right from 4th, 5th day up to around 12th day, you may get a good picture in the CT. So even if you want to know the severity of involvement, wait till the 5th or 6th day, unless it is progressing very fast and there is a premature inflammatory phase with cytokine storm, then the situation is totally different. So I hope I have made clear what is the role. Of course, for giving convalescent plasma also, the first phase is the preferred one. Alright. So the minor details about inflammation and coagulation, I will leave aside. Also, so about the COVID-associated coagulopathy, as I said, it is a hypercoagulable state with thrombotic event, thrombotic tendency, just like DIC. The difference being that COVID-associated coagulopathy is prothrombotic, whereas DIC you get more of bleeding-related complications. There is raised PT, APTT, there is increased platelets, there is increased fibrinogen, increased D-dimer, increased factor 8, and increased 1 millibrand factor. So these all are suggestive of COVID-associated coagulopathy, and this is why we go for testing our D-dimer, to know whether the amount of COVID-associated coagulopathy, which may end up giving thrombus to your heart, giving you MI, or thrombus to your brain, giving you stroke. Sometimes D-dimer kits are not available. So what I do is I go for D-dimer equivalents. We can get PTINR tested. We can get a 1 millibrand factor tested, or a fibrinogen tested. Or if factor 8 is available, which is available at many centers. So they may give the same information as D-dimer. So if D-dimer is not available, usually D-dimer is the one which is preferred and commonly used. But if we need to take a call and D-dimer is not available in your city, you may go for D-dimer equivalents. So there is a activation of the thrombotic coagulation pathway. I may skip about the theoretical part. So to address this thing, the COVID-associated coagulopathy, we may use what we call it as heparin, that is anticoagulant. Please remember, it is anticoagulant, heparin, not antiplatelet. So it is either heparin or enoxaparin. Some studies have also shown role of NOAC, that is newer oral anticoagulant, like dabigatran, apixaban, rivaroxaban, but not aspirin, not clopidogrel. They are antiplatelets. The role is more of anticoagulation, and if possible, you go for a subcutaneous enoxaparin. Very easily available, easily applicable, subcutaneous, once a day dosing, very simple. Conventional heparin may require to be given in a drip, may need more frequency, 3 to 4 times a day. So what they have suggested, that a lower molecular weight heparin may be given in all hospitalized patients. Very simple. So it reduces the COVID-associated coagulopathy and may prevent the deterioration of the lung picture. Also, there is something called a therapeutic dose and a prophylactic dose of your enoxaparin. Prophylactic dose means enoxaparin OD, therapeutic dose means enoxaparin BD. It can be decided on by calculating something known as SIC score, sepsis-induced coagulopathy. My previous video has detailed discussion on that. Something about each medications now. So steroids. We know that steroids form the mainstay of treatment. Methylprednisolone, dexamethasone, both are equally effective. The doses being a bit different for both, and the output has really changed the management of COVID-19, especially in the second half of the disease progression. And the utility is coming out of the University of Oxford trial, which is called Recovery Trial. And the final results were published in September 2020, which is confirming the previous reports in the initial reports, that IV as well as oral dexamethasone may reduce the 28-day mortality by 17% among hospitalized patients. But the caveat is the patient should be having oxygen requirement. So steroid should only be given in patient having oxygen requirement and not to all the patient. So this thing is something to be remembered. Whereas enoxaparin can be given in all hospitalized patients. So thromboprophylaxis is not a very difficult decision. If you start in the initial phase, even enoxaparin, then also it is fine. But if you give early steroid, it may worsen the viremia. It may cause rapid progression of the initial viremic phase by lowering our immunity. And later on, when the actual stage may come, where steroid may be required, you may end up blunting the immune response to the steroids, the host response to the steroid, and the effect of steroid may not be as much as we would have expected. So please remember, don't give early steroid. Let your physician decide. If hypoxia is there, it's a clear-cut decision, you give steroids. But without hypoxia, it's a very expert-level decision. Please take help from your physician. Don't give steroid blanket or blindly. This is my message to all of you. So apart from steroids and Clexane, there are three other approved medications which can be considered in our patients. Not all patients required, and very selected patient based on very precisely given criteria. we take the call. Apart from this, there are several other investigational therapies being tried, researched. In my previous presentation, I had the entire list of which are the investigational therapy. And to date, even many centers, many big institutes use so many other investigational therapy. I won't name them because they have not been approved. They have not been studied in detail. They have not been under rigorous trial and evidence-based practice. So I will only speak about what have been approved and what are genuinely the ones we should be use if required. First and foremost being remdesivir. Please remember, remdesivir is only used for moderate to severe category of COVID in the initial 10 days and with patients requiring oxygen supplementation. So now you know the logic why remdesivir initial 10 days. That is the viral phase. After that, there is no utility because then we are into the inflammatory game. All right. Similarly, tocilizumab is the one which is considered only when there is a severe disease with rapid deterioration. IL-6 is rising 100, 200. There is evidence of cytokine storm. All the markers are rising. The O2 requirement. Patient was on room air before 2 days and now the patient is suddenly on BiPAP. So if the deterioration is rapid or if you are given steroid for 24 to 48 hours, but there hardly seems to be any response to it. The patient is not static, but worsening and worsening. Only in such cases, tocilizumab should be given. And the plasma therapy is indicated only in initial 7 days. All right. So we'll discuss a few points about each. So about remdesivir, we have already discussed so many times that it is contraindicated firstly in patients with severe liver and renal impairment and in pregnant and lactating female and in children. All right. And remdesivir is not a life-saving drug. The trial which was done for remdesivir, this is the exact trial paper which I have shown you. It only says that remdesivir was superior to placebo in shortening the time to recovery in adults who were hospitalized with COVID-19 and had evidence of lower respiratory tract infection. It nowhere mentions that it decreases the mortality, whereas steroids decrease the mortality. Right? So antiviral, if possible, if the patient is having early deterioration in the 10 days, you can give, of course. But it is not life-saving. Please understand this thing. So even your health ministry has specifically stated that remdesivir is not a life-saving drug in COVID-19. It should only be given in hospital settings. It should never be used in home settings. There are many patients, many doctors insisting to use remdesivir at home. Just like O2 therapy, O2 cylinder therapy is legally not permissible to use at home. Similarly, remdesivir is also not permissible legally to use at home, and also it is a medication which requires a certain level of monitoring, which is possible only in hospitalized patients. Right? So the guidelines for home care are very clear. The home care patient are never on oxygen. Home care is only allowed for patients which are not on oxygen. Right? And in such patients, the criteria of remdesivir does not fit. Similarly, if the patient is requiring oxygen, the patient has to be admitted. All right. So you don't insist on remdesivir in home treatment. This is very important. Similarly, tocilizumab is also a very toxic molecule. Please use it in very, very selective patients, which evidence there. IL-6 is doubling or three times the upper normal limit. Ferritin doubling within 24 hours. CRP more than 100 with doubling within 24 hours. These are the signs of cytokine storm. You have given steroid for 24 to 48 hours. The patient is not improving. And you have got a procalcitonin done and the patient is not suggestive of any secondary bacterial infection, then and then only you give tocilizumab. Remember, tocilizumab is not a wonder drug. Even after tocilizumab, you may get very secondary complication, infection, fungal infection, so many things. So please remember, it is not a miraculous drug. Although the trials have given good data that if it is used in selected number of patients with hypoxia and significant inflammation, that is a cytokine storm, treatment with combined use of systemic corticosteroid and tocilizumab reduces mortality by about 1/3 for patients requiring simple oxygen and nearly 1/2 for those having invasive mechanical ventilation. This is also from the recovery trial. The data is published in February 2021. So in selected cases where you require, you use steroids, you use tocilizumab. Also, steroid overuse, longer use is associated with so many secondary infection, fungal infection, even mucormycosis in diabetics. So please understand, judicious and timely initiation. And for this purpose, you definitely get aid from your physician. So about the convalescent plasma, the trial which has been studied in the JAMA and published in June 2020 said that it did not significantly improve the time to clinical improvement within the 28-day period. Of course, it has been approved in India and it is commonly used and should be used in the initial 7 days in patients with moderate disease who, despite using steroid for initial part, do not improve. Then you may consider it the usage of plasma. So the same recovery trial has suggested there has been no convincing evidence of convalescent plasma on clinical outcome patient admitted to hospital with COVID-19. However, the guidelines which is followed in India is what is there on your skin. We use it commonly. We have seen moderate efficacy of plasma therapy. So it may be considered in selected cases, but the decision should be of your physician. If your physician advises, even if on call based on the criteria, then you may order plasma for your patient. So there are criteria for donor and recipient. You may go through it. For recipient, as I said, that within 7 days, and if you measure the antibody should be absent in the recipient, then and then only you may consider giving plasma. And the many are asking questions about who can donate plasma. Then you just may go through the this list mentioned on the left, that are the criteria for plasma donation. Something which we discussed in detail in our previous video about the early safe early self-proning in awake and non-intubated patient. We already know about the role of proning. It expands the lungs, it reduces O2 requirement by up to 5%, and it may bias time for our host immune system to act, our steroids to act, our other medications to act. It decreases the usage of O2 cylinders. It decreases the progression to severe disease. It may decrease the need for invasive and non-invasive ventilation. The previous protocol which we discussed last time was the NIH protocol, which I had shown the slide, it was we had discussed this in back in June 2020, and fortunately and to my satisfaction, now the Ministry of Health and Family Welfare also has given a very good guideline about awake self-proning, and they have included the same pick which we discussed last time. So the proning criteria and the proning procedure they have given, this is for awake patient who are not in ICU. You may need 3 to 4 pillows as shown in the figure. You may keep one below the face, one or two below the chest up to the lower side of thigh, and then one below the leg. And patient may try to be as much as comfortable just by making random adjusting movements. So you can keep on changing. You can go for around 30 minutes to 1 hour in prone, then left lateral, then right lateral, then you can again sit for a while. So you can keep on changing positions, but stay as much as you can tolerate in the proning position. You can do it up to 16 hours a day if you are comfortable with it. Just make sure you don't get any pressure sores and any other injuries around. And who cannot go for proning, you should avoid proning, are the ones who are pregnant, ones having deep vein thrombosis, some cardiac problems, or some pelvic or femur or spine fractures. They may not be able to prone properly. See, this is something which we advise to all admitted patients, irrespective of O2 requirement. And it can be done by the patient once you show the patient. It's very easy procedure. The process of ICU proning is a technically demanding thing for which your ICU staff needs to be trained sufficiently. For the awake self-proning, the method is very simple, as I have explained to you. Lastly, but not the least, recently on 23rd April, Zydus has published the press release of emergency use approval from our Drug Controller General of India for the use of pegylated interferon alpha 2b. They call it as Virafin in treating moderate COVID-19 infection in adults. And this is a trial paper of phase 2 trial. I tried searching the phase 3 data, but it is still not available. Even the label and the branding is still in process, it seems. But what I could gather was the phase 2 trial data, and the trial was done at Ahmedabad itself. It provides initial evidence for potential use of a single dose of Virafin, 1 milligram per kg dose, in treatment of moderate COVID-19 disease. That's what they say. The significant improvement in clinical status on day 15 is likely due to faster viral reduction compared to others with the PEG interferon alpha 2b treated subjects, showing a difference as early as on 7th day and becoming significant by day 14. So this is what they say, that it may reduce the duration of viral shedding and viral viremia. And what they observed was that by day 7, the patient's RT-PCR got tested negative. So they basically mean to say is that initial usage of subcutaneous single dose, 1 milligram per kg, PEG interferon alpha 2b may lead to rapid viral clearance, and they may reduce the viral load or the affect the viremic phase. Also, it is still under trial and only emergency use approval is given. So this is still an evolving condition. So as we happen to use it and get more data for phase 3 trial, we may be able to give more comment on it. So to summarize today's session, we have already discussed each aspect. So I'll just highlight 2-3 things. Please remember the day 1 of the symptom is very important. This has to be the take home message. And initial viral phase, we treat it using antiviral. The later on, we treat the pathophysiology, COVID associated coagulopathy by anticoagulants, and the hyperinflammation by using steroids. All right. So this is in the NLR ratio. If it is greater than 3.5, it is suggestive of moderate category of disease. All the investigations, the HRCT thorax, we have discussed everything. So I think that's all for today's discussion. And yes, this is the reference list of all the various materials which I have used in preparing this slide. In fact, this is the 14th or 15th revision of my PowerPoint, which has happened over last 1.5 years. So please visit these individual sites if you want for more information. And at the end, I would like to make an appeal. First of all, I would congratulate each one of you who has vaccinated themselves. India has reached a mark of 150 million COVID vaccine doses, which is the fastest in the world as we sit and discuss today. 15 crore vaccines have been given, doses have been given. I have also taken the first dose and the second dose. You can see the picture, and it's very, very safe. My appeal to all the youngsters from age group 18 to 45, soon in a day or so, entire India is starting campaign and vaccination for age group 18 to 45. Please register yourself on COWIN website and get vaccinated. It's very, very safe. Whichever vaccine is available, Covishield, Covaxin, both are very, very good, very, very safe. Take 2 doses and along with it, keep wearing mask. See, I have taken the vaccine. You take picture, you take selfie, you send to me, upload in our group. We would be happy to retweet or share with all. But please don't forget that vaccine only works once the virus has entered the body. So mask and distancing has to be continued. There is no option to mask. Mask is something which directly prevents the entry of the virus particle itself into the respiratory passage in your body. I have a separate video of maskology discussing everything about masks, type of masks, everything. You can go through it. Please get vaccinated, but also wear masks. This is the humble request from my side. Invite your schoolmates, your friends, your past school friends, college friends who are above 18, get them registered, get going and upload your selfie. So it's a way to protect our country from the third and further waves. By doing so, you may also protect your family members. The young generation may be having mild infection or maybe asymptomatic, but they infect their family members and then their family members get into a very serious state of disease, and we know what the results can be like. So this is the process of registering. If you are above 18 years of age, please go and get yourself vaccinated. It's a humble request. It is a duty. It is a service to the nation. It is a service to our society. It is a service to humanity. It is a service to our fellow citizens. It is the service to nature, is service to the world. Because if you get vaccinated, you may protect yourself and you may prevent you infecting others. And if you stay healthy, then you may help the entire world in fighting this pandemic. So it's a humble appeal. It's a humble request to all of you. Please go register yourself and get vaccinated whenever your turn comes. So you can take a screenshot. These are the guidelines for vaccination. Lastly, so this was the entire topic about management of a moderate category of COVID-19 infection. Also, the video about home management and mild cases, we already upload so many times on YouTube, and we keep on posting regular update on YouTube as well as on our Telegram channel. If you want, and if required, and if I can make it possible, we'll try to make a video on ICU management of COVID as well. But since it is a expert level thing, I don't think all the general public or all the medics and paramedics and graduates of various fields may need such detailed discussion. Whatever I have discussed today, if you implement, if you start using, almost we can fight 90 to 95% of COVID patients. Leave the 5% to experts. We will manage them in our ICUs. But if you can manage the 90% workload, especially the moderate category, and give timely treatment as we have discussed, then you may prevent progression to severe disease and you may save so many lives and be the real reason for which you have become a doctor. So thank you so much. This is a tagline which I have been using all over all my training sessions. We have defeated swine flu. We shall defeat corona too. So thank you so much. You can see the previous discussion, which is the previous part of what we have discussed today. Some of them which I have skipped in detail on the YouTube video all about corona, which is available on the YouTube channel www.youtube.com/RajeshTeli. You can also get all the links, all the videos, all the PowerPoint presentation, including this presentation, in a group on Telegram which we have created, that is called COVID-19 Research Outreach India. And you can just go to Telegram or just type this thing, t.me/COVIndia. In Telegram, you directly search COVINDIA and you will get our group. You can join the group and then you can download all the PowerPoints, all the videos. We can have a discussion. You can put on your suggestions and questions and we can battle out this pandemic together for the months and years to come. Thank you so much. And I wish you a great success in fighting this pandemic. Thank you.